words to this because you're all kind of my age. And so if the Spirit moves you, you can sing with us. And if you want to clap like Baptists, you can clap like Baptists. And you can do whatever you want, okay? So this is, think of this as me leading a sing-along, okay? So let's see what we got here. You can play the game, you can act out your part, though it wasn't written for you. What you gonna do with your broken heart, shamed of playing the fool? One thing can lead to another, I know, doesn't take any sacrifice. Oh, father and mother, sister and brother, if it feels nice, don't think twice. Shower the people you love with love. Show them the way that you feel. Things are gonna be much better if you only will. Shower the people you love with love. Show them the way that you feel. Things are gonna work out better if you only will. You can run, but you cannot hide. This is widely known. And what you gonna do with your foolish pride when you're all by yourself alone? Once you tell someone the way you feel, you can feel it beginning to ease. I think it's true what they say about the squeaky wheel always getting the grease. Shower the people you love with love. Show them the way that you feel. Things are gonna be out fine if you only will. Shower the people you love with love. Show them the way that you feel. Things are gonna be much better if you only will.
The God of peace be with you all.
And also with you.
Good morning. Welcome to worship at Zion Lutheran Church of Pittsfield. Always a delight to be gathered together in the company of friend and stranger, both our neighbors that God has given us to love. And we gather in the sight and in the mercy of God, who draws us together from many places. So we know some of you have been attending this church since you were babies. Some of you are just stopping in maybe for the very first time. Some of you are not actually in this church building at all. You're attending online, not just in the Berkshires, but all over the country. And for this gift of God's wide reach, we give thanks and praise. So, my name is Pastor Joel Berglund, and just a couple notes on the service for those of you in the room. I am wearing a mask because I was exposed to COVID earlier in the week. I tested several times, all negative. I would not be here, obviously, if I were positive, but I will be masking anytime I am in front of the table, when I preach, and when I preside at the table, I will remove my mask. And you all should feel free to mask if you would like to, anywhere in the building at any time, because we are still good hospital capacity in Berkshire County. Masking is optional. and we are singing today, so feel free to sing or not sing as your own kind of safety allows. And make sure you've got one of those red hymnals. When it comes time for communion, all people, regardless of background, are welcome at this table because this is not my table. This is not the table of Zion. This is not the table of the Lutheran Church. This is the table of Jesus, who welcomes all people into his love and mercy. I'll give you more logistical instructions when we get there. But for now, as you are able, please rise and face the font. As one body, we confess our faith, or confess our sin, and receive God's mercy. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who looks upon us in compassion, forgives our sin, and heals our lives. Amen. Amen. Have mercy, O God. Against you, you alone, we have sinned. In your compassion, cleanse us from our sin and take away our guilt. Create in us a new heart and give us a steadfast spirit. Do not cast us away, but fill us with your Holy Spirit and restore your joy within us. Amen. As tender as parent to child, so deep is God's compassion for you. As high as heaven is above earth, so vast is God's love for you. As far as east is from west, so far God removes your sin from you, renewing your life through Jesus Christ. Blessed be God who crowns us with mercy and love. Blessed be God forever. We sing together. Let us pray. Benevolent God, you are the source, the guide, and the goal of our lives. Teach us to love what is worth loving, to reject what is offensive to you, and to treasure what is precious in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Thanks be to God.
So if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever in you is earthly: fornication, impurity, passion, evil desire, and greed, which is idolatry. On account of these, the wrath of God is coming on those who are disobedient. These are the ways you also once followed when you were living that life. But now you must get rid of all such things: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and abusive language from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have stripped off the old self with its practices and have clothed yourselves with a new self, which is being renewed in knowledge according to the image of its creator. In that renewal, there is no longer Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, and free, but Christ is all and in all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Someone in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Friend, who set me to be a judge or arbitrator over you?" And he said to them, "Take care. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions." Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly, and he thought to himself, "What should I do? For I have no place to store my crops." Then he said, "I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, 'Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you. And the things you have prepared, whose will they be?' So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace and peace in the name of Jesus. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity. Who needs coffee when you got Ecclesiastes? Here you thought you were coming to church just like normal, and you were going to hear a little bit about hope, or a little bit about sharing, or a cute anecdote from your pastor's life. But no. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity. How did this get into the Bible? Aren't we supposed to hear we're special and loved? Aren't we supposed to hear we make a difference? Aren't we supposed to hear that it all adds up to something in the end? Not today. The writer here cuts to the heart of things from the get-go. All is vanity. In Hebrew, the word is havel. And a more direct translation for it is not vanity, but vapor. Specifically, like a breath vapor. The kind you see on cold mornings outside. You breathe out, and there it is, the havel. You cannot catch it. You cannot control it. You cannot make it stay. It just blooms out and disappears. Such is life, says the author. And he knows. He tells us that he's worked really hard to try to find some place in this life that is not the vapor. He tells us how he's worked and toiled with his hands, but he sees that it brings nothing lasting. You build the sandcastle and the waves take it out. So he becomes wise, and he learns all the wisdom he can, thinking perhaps there is not vapor, but all the wisdom does is show him that life is vapor. And he actually ends up more unhappy than he was before. And so he considers that, you know, maybe he's part of some larger scheme, that he's planting seeds that future generations will harvest. And then he considers the children he has. And he considers that they are going to have full control of whatever he leaves them when he dies. And that they're going to go hog wild with all that he's worked for on whatever they want, wise or foolish, and there's nothing he can do about it. It's all vapor. And so he begins to worry. And even the anxiety is no respite, for as he worries and loses sleep at night, he realizes that even the worry is part of the vapor. There is no place he can go, no thing he can do to stop his vaporous state. Nothing he can do to remove him from being part of a life that looks like breath on a cold morning. The author, other places in the book, will point out that there are relative differences in the kind of vapor we might have in our lives, but in the big picture, they're the same. Sure, a wise person might enjoy a richer existence than a fool, but they meet the same fate in the end. Sure, leaving some sort of legacy behind is better than not, but no one's going to remember you in 300 years anyway. So then why? When my alarm went off this morning at 4:30 a.m., did I not just turn it off and go back to sleep? Why did I get up, put my feet on the floor, walk down my stairs, turn on the coffee pot, and stare at my computer screen until inspiration came? I mean, no one's going to remember this sermon. I'm very complimented, by the way, by your protestations otherwise after the service. Oh, no, Pastor Joel, you're a great preacher. Listen, no one's going to remember this sermon. And even if they do, they're, you know, the grave's coming for us all. Same for you and for me, right? So, at this point in my sermon preparation, I went to church. And the church internet gave out, as if to remind me that my life is really vapor and I can build nothing lasting. My online word processor no longer worked. I had to hurry and scurry to see if we could resolve the problem. I think we could. And then I went home to finish my sermon as best I could. All is vanity, am I right? So here I've done a really nice job, I hope, of setting up some big questions, and then I had an hour knocked out of my morning, and so all you get is my rough notes for answering these problems. And this too is vanity. So first of all, I want to say that if our life is like breath on a cold morning, and it's fleeting and largely out of our control, then let us remember that there is one doing the exhaling. God is the source of our life, fleeting though it may be. If our life is havel, then God is the breath that puts it out into the universe. And perhaps this whole universe is one giant exhale from our limitless creator, blooming in unpredictable ways and unfolding strangely day by day. And if we're a part of that exhale, then our lives are a ride on the breath of God. Life is really strange because we just kind of show up and wonder what it is, and then we're not here anymore. But that's a gift from God, strange though it may be. And as much as we want to quarrel with the terms on which it is given, it is still a gift. And then our job becomes to receive it. And this shifts things a little bit for me. If our life is a ride on God's breath, then you can stop the games. And you can enjoy the ride. And suddenly I'm no longer living to try to be remembered. I'm not living to be good or to be wise or to make something of myself. I'm not living to do anything. I'm living because. I'm living because God has called me into this world to partake of this really strange, vaporous gift. How might our lives look a little bit different if we lived because rather than lived to? It's a hard shift for us to make, of course. There's actually a really interesting etymological thing that happens in the Hebrew here in Ecclesiastes that we don't get in English. So let me nerd out for a little bit. It talks about how all of life is chasing the wind. This is a refrain that you hear over and over if you read the book of Ecclesiastes, which if you don't want to get sleep, you should read right before bedtime. Chasing the wind. Chasing is actually more related to the verb for tending, as a shepherd would tend a flock. Try to fence it in, try to make sure it stays in one place, trying to herd the wind. And wind, of course, in Hebrew, is the same word for spirit. God wants us to ride on God's breath, but we try to herd the Spirit. And you see the fences we try to build. You see all the different ways we try to hem it in, make it last. Today, obviously, all four texts talk about a big one: wealth and greed. I think the reason that wealth and greed are singled out is because they so enable the illusion of security. They can give the false impression that things are stable, that things are under your control, that you have made something for yourselves, that you have earned your way out of being vapor. But the Spirit will not be herded. You fool, says God. One way or another, the illusion shatters. And we remember that all is vanity, all is vapor. So receive this strange gift that God gives. A ride on God's breath that maybe you didn't ask for, but here you are. Receive this life. No need to make it anything it's not. No need to make it something lasting. Receive it as a gift. and enjoy it. And by the way, I don't think that means eating more ice cream. I don't think that means sleeping in on Sundays. I actually think the best way we partake of this gift is by neighbor love, is by reverencing the Holy One whenever we see it. Somewhere between our living and our dying, our growth and decay, we know that though our life is fleeting, it is held by the One who is its source. In our daily living, fleeting as it is, we can sense something eternal at work. The Holy One breathing, constantly breathing this whole universe into existence. May you know this One breathing in you. Amen. As one church, let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
All people of God, let us pray to Christ Jesus. O God, you are the wholeness. We are the division. Bring conciliation and healing. Guide us to build up your church, and we were made whole in you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, you are the source of all life. Where creation cries out for distress, bring relief and renewal. Bless farmers, ranchers, distributors, and all who provide our food. Nourish the land and all its inhabitants. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, your wisdom. Where nations and communities yearn for peace, bring justice. Strengthen those who work for the welfare of others, especially military personnel, police, first responders, and activists. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, you are life. Where your people and overwhelmed in the busyness of life, bring encouragement. Accompany all who experience emotional, mental, and physical distress. Renew us day by day. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, you are treasure. Where scarcity and anxiety pervade your church, bring abundance and vitality. Guide the work of the church, council, and communities, and give them clarity, especially in our dealing with Berkshire Housing. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God of healing, we give thanks for people you have given us to love. We pray that you care for those who need we cannot meet, for those bodies are struggling and we cannot fix, those who are struggling and we cannot heal. We pray for Pat, Betty, Dan, Rumi, Driven, Marilyn, Mike, Tracy, Doris, Janet, Patricia, Megan, Jay, Steve, Bridget, and Katie, and those we now name aloud or in our hearts.
Dan.
Uncle Terry, Aunt Sandy, Uncle Joe, Seamus.
Teresa, Haley, Beth. Dahlia, Jordan and Linda, Brian.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of comfort, we remember our beloved who have died. In your tender care, hold them and all who give them passing, and give us faith in your resurrection hope. Today, we remember Ruth, and those now we name aloud or silently in our hearts.
Jack Ross.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We entrust ourselves and our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share and receive a sign of peace with the people around you. If you're worshiping online, greet others with a sign of peace in the comments.
So we another sing-along is a Carol King song, so if you know the words, please sing along with you, and I promise I won't go flat this time. So.
And you need a helping hand, and nothing or nothing is going right. Close your eyes and think of me, and soon I will be running to see you again. got to do is call, and I'll be there. You've got a friend. If the sky above you should turn dark and full of cloud, and that old north wind should begin to blow, keep your head together and call. Just call out my name, and you know wherever I am, I'll come running to see you again. Winter, spring, summer, or fall, all you've got to do is call, and I'll be there. Got a friend, ain't it good to know that you got a friend? Ain't it good to know you've got a friend? Oh yeah, got a friend.
God of goodness and growth, all creation is yours, and your faithfulness is sure. Word and water, wine and bread, those are the signs of your abundant grace. Receive the gifts we bring and nourish us to proclaim your abiding love in our communities and in the world throughout. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, and strength. Amen.
This is God's table. All people are welcome here. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, We praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy,
Lord God of power. We praise you, all holy God, for the universe beyond our knowing, for lands and seas and all their animals, for your covenant people throughout time, and for friends and strangers and family. We praise you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who on the night before he died took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We pray for your Holy Spirit, your breath, your fire, your wisdom. Nourish us with the body and blood of Christ and renew the world with your mercy. We praise you, all holy God, today, tomorrow, and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught.
Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed
be
thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy
will
be
done,
on
earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread.
Forgive us
our trespasses,
as
we forgive
those
who trespass against
us.
And lead us
not
into
temptation,
but deliver us
from
evil.
For
thine
is the kingdom,
and the power,
and
the glory,
forever
and ever.
Amen.
Amen. All people are welcome to receive communion at this table. You will come forward as led by an usher, and I will give you a piece of this bread, which does contain gluten. If you desire a gluten-free or dairy-free, or this doesn't contain dairy, excuse me. We're good. Honey, flour, water, we're good. These contain no gluten, so if you need a no-gluten wafer, just let me know. The dark-colored liquid is wine. The light-colored liquid is grape juice. If you desire a blessing rather than communion, simply cross your arms and I will be able to bless you. And if you're not able to come forward for any reason, I will find you and bring communion to you in your seat. Taste and see that God is good. body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
If you have announcements for the good of this church or enrichment of our lives and community, Erica has the microphone.
There's a whole bunch of, we have, this week, we have Walla Walla onions, we have garlic, we have yellow squash and zucchini squash back there. And what else we have? Green beans. We have green beans. Lots of green beans. So it's all for your tables. Go and...
At Zion in the summer, we've got the table in front and we've got the table in back, right? Go ahead, Margaret.
And then we have the table up there. Our coffee table. Please join us for coffee and fellowship after church. And if you'd like to be a part of it and sign up for a coffee hour, please, the sign-up sheet is in the back. Thank you.
Thank you for bringing in things for the blessing box. I looked again today because I filled it up on Sundays, and we really need sunscreen and... Sunscreen, what? And a better memory. So sunscreen, but there's something else. I'll tell you next Sunday. Okay, Amy.
Thank you, Tom and Cheryl, for sharing music with us this morning. Thank you very much. Lovely. And I want to let you know, we are open for flowers on the 21st of August, and a few weeks down the road, and September 4 is open also. If you'd like to sign up, it's back there also. Oh, and Cheryl remembered.
Deodorant. And my announcement is just yesterday I had the pleasure, Jim and I had the pleasure of being at the dedication of my Habitat client whose house was dedicated, and there were probably, I don't know, 30 people there maybe, and Zion was mentioned because we have, Zion and St. Stephen's has worked over there, had a work day. But I was just so excited, and I wanted to share it with you because she's a first-time home buyer, and it's a duplex, and it's with her best friend of 30 years who has the other half of the house. So they're going to be able to move in shortly, and it's a big day. Thank you.
Thank you.
Another thing in the back are, there's a variety of signups, but we're looking for volunteers for Shakespeare in the Park. As you saw in the weekly announcements, it's ideal teams of two, but it can be more. And if we can get people to commit to a few days, then just really a handful of teams can cover all the dates. If you've not done it before, I'm happy to answer any questions. And there are typically rain dates as well, so. And they call them pretty much right at showtime. The only date I'm unsure about is third Thursday, because there is the park's double book, so they could figure that one out.
If you're going to see Shakespeare in the Park, you might as well sign up for some popcorn sales. There are three remaining backyard Bible studies left in the summer. Tomorrow's is... We're at your place, right? At Mark and Ginny's, 6:30 p.m. If you want the address or if you want the Bible study texts in advance, sign up online or talk to me, and I'll make sure to send those out tomorrow morning. And then it will be at my house, and then it will be at John and Kate's house, and then we're going to be done for the summer. And then a reminder that after church, we are going to stack all of the chairs except for just these two rows on this side. And those are for people who choose to stay for a forum of information, of updates on what's going on with our project with Berkshire Housing. If you've attended one in July, we don't need you there again, but if you haven't, today is literally the last day in July, so I encourage your attendance if you have the time. And if you don't, I encourage you to reach out to me or to Jim McGrath, and we can bring you up to speed on everything that's transpiring there. And the last announcement is, again, the Sung dismissal. Just in case you haven't done this, this side is going to follow me on the third stanza, and this side is going to look to Tom on the third stanza, and you're going to have to jump right in. And, you know, I got to say, we've been improving on this every single week. So
last week was the best. So
kudos
far.
To you. Yeah. Yeah. So with that, please rise as we close in song.
stand. We all need somebody to lean on me. When you're not strong, I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on. For won't be long, I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. So just call on me, brother, when you need a hand. I just might have a problem that you'll understand. We all need somebody to lean on me. When you're not strong, I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long. I'm gonna somebody to lean on, lean on.
Thanks for buttoning up with me.
No, it's fine. It's kind of, it's very demoralizing when they're doing that while you're singing, isn't it? It's horrible. I know, they just totally ignore you. I know, I know, I know. It's very rude. It's, I'm sorry.
That's all right.
Never know what they're. It depends on. Yeah, that's right. Thank you, Tom. You're a champ. Hi.